submitted under the public health guidelines during the anti-Black racism protests. So those protests, there was a recognition that this was an issue that a lot of people cared about, that they wanted to take to the streets and have their voices heard. And, you know, and the fact that there were technical violations of, you know, certain orders didn't matter so long as, well, there weren't real threats to public health or public order. So in this case, I'd want to know what it is that the city is relying on to say this does pose a threat. I think that we are, as an organization, the Canadian Civil Liberties Association is not saying that, you know, the right to protest and to express yourself have no limits. But what we're saying is that when the government is imposing those limits, then they have to justify them and explain why.
Well, I think, like, you know, and again, the situations that have happened around this city and in other cities, that the longer they stay, then the more they become entrenched, the more, you know, there's situations for crime and fire, and it's a safety hazard after a certain period of time, because it's just not meant to be a permanent situation. So, you know, again, I'm sure those are factors, like, you know, as opposed to, well, you just, you know, they're not really harming anybody, you got to leave them there. You know, we can leave them there. And again, I can see that for a short period of time, but certainly as the more they become entrenched, it becomes more of a, I think it does become more of a safety issue. What about, you know, in this case, and you know, we've certainly seen post George Floyd a great discussion in regard to racism, systemic racism and such. And I think there's lots of people out there that want to have that discussion. Then all of a sudden, well, it's, you know, we're with Black Lives Matter or with whatever cause, and we want to reduce funding by 50% to the police. Do you think once it gets to sort of those extremes that people, they bail, they're out? You know, like, yeah, you know what, there should be, as you talked about, people marching about, you know, the situation in, with Black Lives Matter or policing or whatever you want to discuss. And then, you know, all of a sudden it becomes from a discussion of how do we do this and how do we balance this to, well, let's defund something by 50%. Do you think at that point you lose the public?
You know, I really don't know. I think that there's obviously a group of committed individuals that are involved in this movement, you know, in Hamilton, and certainly there are committed activists throughout the country that are looking at this issue and that really want to engage on it. So, you know, maybe it's not a position that has the support of the majority of the public, but that's one of the reasons that you engage in protest is to get people to pay attention, to get them to think about it, and also to get a bit of an opportunity to negotiate with decision makers about these issues.
So what are your thoughts in regard, obviously, COVID fatigue? People are, we don't need to go through that. We know how everybody's feeling. And we, you know, before the weekend, we saw the situation at that barbecue place in Etobicoke. And, you know, sort of moved from a, you know, a guy just trying to open up and sell his wares to all of a sudden we had Antifa there. We had QAnon. You had extremes on both sides of the political spectrum, and everybody sort of jumping on board. And then you have to wonder, well, is this, you know, just a case of for everybody to come out and demonstrate whatever they want to demonstrate, or is this about the guy in his restaurant? Your thoughts on how that all transpired?
Yeah, I think, I mean, in any instance where someone is, you know, protesting or taking a stand and getting the attention of some media, there are going to be people and groups that will decide to sort of hop on and see if they can, change the direction of the spotlight in their direction. That I think, you know, it happens. I think that, you know, in some ways we shouldn't be too distracted by some of the really, we both shouldn't be too distracted by some of these fringe groups, and also shouldn't necessarily give them more attention than they necessarily deserve. And we should focus on the fact, and regardless of whether you know, agree or disagree with the position or with the tactics, the fact is that people who are protesting or, you know, taking a stand in relation to public health measures, it's very easy for, and I saw a lot over the weekend of this in, you know, in the press where these kinds of protests were just sort of dismissed as people who, you know, think the virus is a hoax, or people who are really don't care about the health and safety of people. I think that that's an easy way to dismiss this. But the fact is that there are many people who appreciate that there's a very significant public health concern going on here, but also feel that the restrictions that have been put in place by the government are excessive, that many of them are arbitrary, that they don't make sense, that some of them have, you know, disparate impacts depending on who you are and what your circumstances are, and they affect people very differently. And the normal avenues that people have to deal with these things, you know, contacting your MPP and going, even potentially going to court, a lot of those things are not really functioning the way they normally do. You know, the legislature of Ontario no longer really has any oversight over the pandemic measures. This has become, these are executive orders. The government passed a bill so that they don't have to go back to the legislative assembly and repeatedly get their approval to extend the state of emergency. They've ended the state of emergency but retained many of their emergency powers. And so when you take away some of those mechanisms, in some cases you don't leave people many opportunities, you know, or other avenues to deal with this. And so sometimes it spills over. And I mean, I saw over the weekend the premier, you know, upset about protesters who are in his neighborhood bothering his neighbors, and you know, he's saying, well, they, you know, they can come to Queen's Park, but I mean, people aren't at Queen's Park right now, right? It doesn't quite get the message across in the same way.
I got to cut you off there, Kara, because we're just plumb right out of time. Kara Zwiebel has been with us, Director of Fundamental Freedoms and Canadian Civil Liberties Association. Kara, thanks for the time. Be well.
Thank you. You too.
It is 1229. It's 900 CHML. I'm Scott Thompson, the Premier's President.